Thank you. State College. If you go to Montclair State College there and you get a degree in testing noses and physical education, you get a degree from the answer school. If you go to the gym to see a basketball game, it's on the left-hand side as you go into the entrance of Montclair College, Pander Gymnasium. That's what it stands for. Fast forward into my coming back to Newark to work for the Sharpe. I haven't heard the name Sharpe James in a long time. But I remember him from a kid that dinner day with my dad down in faculty housing in Piscataway, over at Rutgers. And I see Sharpe James again. But I've never seen Sharpe James. I see him. And I don't have to do anything more than look at Sharpe, the person who's standing in front of me, by the name of Sharpe James, to know this is the same Sharpe James that my parents talked about when I was a kid in the mid-50s, because what was standing in front of me was an athlete. And that's how I've always remembered him. That's how I remember him to this day. Everybody in this room probably remembers, you know, meeting Sharpe for the first time or in some different capacity. I remember Sharpe James first and foremost as an athlete. And in my mind, I have to think that even today, Sharpe James sees himself as the same athlete who, you know, he came pretty close to being in the Olympics. I don't know if people know that, but he, you know, was a great, great athlete. And so those are my earliest memories of Sharpe going back to the 50s. So later on, we're going to have some speakers who are going to, you know, remember Sharpe from other facets of his life, and then Sharpe will speak at the end. But I think now we start with the breakfast, and then, you know, in 20 minutes, half hour or so, we'll have our speakers come up and we'll move through the day. So thanks everyone for coming. We need your support, and even at this point in his life, he still needs us, and you know, we need him, so let's keep him going. Thank you, I'll be back later.
Yeah. I'm gonna see you all around. Thank you.
exact same. I'm assuming everyone can still hear me? One other little tidbit about Hampshire College. Hampshire College men's basketball team in the late 30s, early 40s had a 44-game win streak. It's the third longest in college history. And I see Anthony over here, one more than Seton Hall. 43. Okay, so we're going to get the program moving. Our first speaker is John James. John, I'm sure, as everyone knows, is one of Sharpe's three sons. He's a law school graduate and Army veteran who served on the city council as an at-large and South Ward member. He formerly served as the emergency management coordinator and safety officer at the Essex County Hospital Center, and today is director of the City of Newark's Office of Emergency Management and Homeland Security Division. John's here to talk about his dad.
Good morning, good morning. Is anyone to turn us up? Okay. First and foremost, I want to thank God for waking up everyone today. Seeing fit to take time to come and honor my father. We all love him in the City of Newark. Read about him, you go online, but I think of a family member out of a different perspective. Loving, he was a mentor, he helped everyone that came his way, and he still helps everyone. I would not be the man I am, my brothers would not be, our family would not be, without this strong leadership and guidance. He was a, for those of you who know, as a teacher, it's not something you can just wake up one morning and decide you're going to do that. From the elementary school level all the way up through college, become an athletic director, he was always there. And I think we need to give people respect and honor when they're still living. So through that, I want to recognize my mother who's here. Phone and meetings with the White House, federal authorities, state authorities, and I just want to do my best to sit this door, but most importantly, honor my father, his legacy, his legend, and our family. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Our next speaker is the Reverend Dr. Mamie Bridgeport, who served as a city council member from the West Ward, succeeding the late Ron Rice in office. She serves as chair of Essex County College's Social Service Division and is pastor of the Faith Christian Center Church in South Orange.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I have the privilege, or the challenge, I should say, of being Sharpe's academic supervisor. If anybody could be his supervisor. I am chairperson of the Division of Social Sciences and the Division of Social Sciences and Physical Education Department, and Sharpe was a faculty member there. And what can I say? Well, first of all, people look at Sharpe as being a great politician. People look at him as being a community activist. I look at him as being an academician. During the period of time that Sharpe was on the faculty of Essex County College, he wrote, along with Harry Nowick and Marshall Brown, the majority of the academic courses in physical education in the college. Not only did he do that, he also taught his students, many of who went on to also become teachers, get their master's degree. At the time that we started out, Essex County College had one building, and we're fortunate today to have the president of Essex County College, Emeritus Dr. Not the Essex County College that started 31 Clinton Street, and it's not the Essex County College that we opened when we opened up the megastructure. What we say at Essex County College is the Essex County College that you see now is the house that Zach built. At that time, Sharpe was on the faculty. I was not a supervisor, I was a student. And I used to see these students running up 10 flights of steps in gym clothes. And I didn't realize that the person that had been doing this, taking PHE 119, was Sharpe James. When we got to the megastructure, I became the supervisor, and I would see him walking in, and he'd be putting up all of these foam things, and he would have the students running around the foam, because we had no gym. And he would have them doing what was called, he would advertise that there would be the turkey trot. And he would tell all the faculty members that they should join the turkey trot. Well, I'm new to college. I wanted to join the turkey trot too until I found out what the turkey trot was. And that is, he would make you run up and down the steps, walk all the way through all the floors, and then come back into the division, and he would make the students take their blood pressure and their heart rate. Why? Because we didn't have a gym like Montclair State. But we had a curriculum that required them to have experiential experience, and that was the experiential experience. When we come to the gymnasium, we would not have a gym if it had not been for Sharpe James going to Dr. Yamba and sitting with Dr. Yamba and showing Dr. Yamba, now when we get ready to go and ask for a design, this is what we need to ask for. Essex County College's gymnasium also has the roof designed in such a way that it would house a swimming pool. We do not have a swimming pool because of the politics of people that look like us didn't need a swimming pool. So that's the reason why we don't have a swimming pool. But guess what? That roof is still there. And at some point in time, you know, you all start doing what y'all got to do, you have a swimming pool. We also have something else that Sharpe has left at the college, and that is the Urban Institute. He is the individual that developed the Urban Institute, which is designed to study urban affairs, urban policies, urban issues, and develop things that our students can take and go out into the world and utilize. That Urban Institute was founded by him, and the first course that he wrote was a course called the state, the politics of New Jersey. All right? And that course was filled with students because they really wanted to know about the politics of New Jersey. But they thought they were going to go in there and find about politics. What they did was they went in there and found out about social policies and legislation. And so the Urban Institute put it this today. Now I wanted to tell you something else about Sharpe, and that is, as a supervisor, I was responsible for evaluating his teaching. I was responsible for recommending whether or not he should be promoted or not. Well, he came into the office and he did like all the faculty. He gave me his letter to let me know that he was going to apply for promotion. I sat down and looked at the criteria, and I had to be honest. He didn't meet the criteria for full professorship at that moment. And being the great supervisor that I am, I sat down and I explained to him everything that he would have to do, and perhaps next year he would be able to apply for full professorship. He sat there with his legs crossed, and he listened to me, and he says, "Thank you very much, Professor Bridgewater." You see, I should have known then that there was going to be an issue. He was so kind and so professional. He calls me about a week later on Saturday night, and he said to me, "I'm going to be on the Bernice Bass Show on tomorrow evening." I said, "Oh, marvelous, Professor James, wonderful." He said, "Because you indicated that I needed to become more adept in some areas, and I'm taking your recommendation very seriously." Mistake number two. So Saturday night, I'm all excited. Sunday night, I'm all excited. I told my husband, I said, "Oh, Professor James is going to be on Bernice Bass, and he's asked me to listen because he's going to be dealing with some of the kinds of issues that we need to address." Well, sir, as my grandmother would say, Sharpe James blistered me on the Bernice Bass show. He talked about how exemplary his services were, all the things he had done, how he was the greatest teacher that ever walked the earth, and how Professor Bridgeforth, the name is Bridgeforth, as indicated, I do not meet the criteria. My husband's sitting in the bed because I told him, "You gotta stay up because you gotta listen to my professor." When Sharpe got finished with me, my husband looked at me and he said, "Damn." So maybe about 15 minutes after his class was off, I picked up the phone, Professor Bridgeforth, chairperson of the Division of Social Sciences. I said, "Yes, Professor James. I got you real good, didn't I? Bam!" I still didn't promote him to the next year. And finally, something I'd like to share with you, and it goes to the character of Sharpe. And it fills in right in the season that we're in, which is the holy season. When Passion of the Christ first came out, I wanted, along with Dr. Gloria Harris, we wanted to have people in Newark see Passion of the Christ. And so we called the Cityplex and we asked them, would they be airing Passion of the Christ in Newark? And we were told no. And we asked why. They said, because people in Newark will not support this kind of film. Now, mind you, they were having all kinds of violent films there, all kinds of carnally, and I won't preach, but carnally revealing films as far as I'm concerned. But they said people in Newark would not come out to see the Passion of the Christ. So we called all over the state of New Jersey, and the nearest place that people from Newark would have been able to see it is they would have had to go all the way down to Middlesex County or down to Ocean County. So I remember coming to Sharpe that day, and I said to him, I said, "Sharpe, let me explain something to you." I said, "These people have determined that our people are unable to appreciate anything but violence and carnality. They will not air the Passion of the Christ in the city of Newark." Sharpe didn't even know what the Passion of the Christ was. All he had to hear was that somebody was doing something that was disrespecting Newark. That's all he had to hear. He had to hear nothing else. Sharpe picked up that phone and he called the movie theater. Movie theater told him the same thing he told me. He said, we wouldn't mind showing you, but our distributors have determined that nationally, when they've done the survey, that this film would be shown anywhere in the country, but it would never have an audience in Newark. Sharpe told them, give me the phone number of your distributor. He called that distributor and says, this is Sharpe James, the mayor of the city of Newark. It's my understanding that you feel that people in Newark cannot see the passion of the Christ. I want you to understand something. If you don't show that movie, you will show no movies from your distribution in this city.
I want to tell you, I'm going to
tell you how awesome God is. They said, yes, they would show the passion of the Christ in Newark. Do you not know the passion in Christ in Newark fall out more than any place in the United States of America? Country to see the passion of the Christ. Even though Sharpe said to me, you know, they're not even speaking in English. What are they talking about? I said, Sharpe, don't worry about it. Jesus has come to save the world. And you have done a good job. So don't worry about it. But he cares about this city. He cares about this city. So it has been a pleasure to work with him as an academician. He cared about sports. When my middle daughter was running at Harvard University for a national title, we drove up there, my family and I. And who do we see sitting in the gym at Harvard all the way on the other side? Now, mind you, I was not an elected official. He had read in the paper that she was from Newark and she was going to be headed for a national title. Sharpe drove all the way up to Harvard to see her run. But that's the kind of person that he is. He is an academician, and I just hope that everybody understands that it's more than just politics with him. Right? He is a multifaceted man. And I would say this to us. Always remember when you look at people that God has a destiny before man has an opinion.
Words to live by. Bessie Walker is a longtime supporter of Sharpe and a tireless worker who served 2 terms in the city council. She's also a member of Russ Baraka's transition team. As a personal connection we have, Bessie is a graduate of Westside High School, as was my father, their graduations 35 years apart. Please welcome to the podium a distinguished Rough Rider.
Thank you, guys. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Well, let me just say thank you, Sharpe, for always supporting the Rough Riders. Mayor Sharpe James, every year of our Hall of Fame, he's given and supported us. Last year, he gave us $5,000 to support. Year before last, he's given us money and to support the Rough Riders of Westside. And y'all forgot. Sharpe taught at Westside High School. I used to see Sharpe running around with his bell-bottom jeans. Everybody know those bell-bottom jeans and that green jacket. So Sharpe was a coach there. You would see him get to class. You always would know who Sharpe was. He was an outgoing coach, and we love Sharpe at Westside. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Sharpe's political career and how it kind of got started. You know, in the late 60s, there was turmoil taking place all around the country and in Newark. Rebellion of 67 and the death of Dr. Martin King brought about unrest throughout the cities. But in 1969, blacks and Puerto Rican people came together who were the majority in the city of Newark. We were still suffering, being disrespected, and being left out of political leadership of our city. People of color were tired of being held down and left back. People, a group of African Americans and Puerto Ricans came together to organize and formulate a relationship that would transform them. These leaders were Floyd, Amiri Baraka Sr., William Wright, community activist, the Committee for Unified Newark, Hilda Hidalgo, Ramon Rivera. This coalition came up with an idea that they would host a Black and Puerto Rican convention where the community would decide who would run in the next election. They had 3 days of a convention, November 15th, 14th, 15th, and 16th, with which they came out with the theme, "We Shall Overcome." It was held at Clinton Place Junior High School. Over 1,000 people participated at this convention and selected the following folks. They selected Mayor Kenneth Gibson to run for mayor. At large, they selected Earl Harris, C. Theodore Pinckney, Donald Tucker, and Ramona Naces. The ward candidates were Al Oliver of the East Ward, Dennis Westbrook of the Central Ward. They decided not to run candidates in the North and the West because they found the numbers were not there to support a victory. However, they needed a South Ward councilman.
Amen.
That's right. During that convention, you know, there was a well-known, articulate, and debonair man by the name of Assemblyman George Richardson, who was running for mayor. Well, he walked out of the convention, and when he walked out, he took another well-known individual with him, the Reverend P. Sharpe, who was running for South Ward. Well, that left a vacancy there. Someone suggested, why don't you go out there and get that father, that husband, that teacher, that coach, and that community activist named Sharpe James. They brought him into the convention. Sharpe accepted their invitation to run as the South Ward councilman. And you all know, it was history. So that ticket formulated as Mayor Gibson, Ken Gibson, Earl Harris, C. Theodore Pinckney, Donald Tucker, Ramon Anastas as the council at large, and of course, Al Oliver, Dennis Westbrook, and of course, that young man out of the South Ward, Sharpe James. You know, this was the most heated and contested election, which required a runoff in June 16th runoff. Of course, the team that won out of that runoff was, of course, Kenneth Allen Gibson was the first African American mayor on the North also stated, wherever Americans' cities are going, Newark will get there first. The others that were elected from that community choice team was Earl Harris at large, Dennis Westbrook, Central Ward, Sharpe James, South Ward. Well, James Sharpe in 1978, Sharpe became the first ward councilman of the South Ward to run in the polls. 1982, James became the first ward councilman to run at large and to garner the most votes in that race ever. For 16 years, Sharpe would be a great and strong supporter of Mayor Gibson. Well, here comes the battle, folks. Y'all know what happened. In 1986, there was a hue and cry for Sharpe change. Of course, this change brought about conflict. It split up families. Some wanted to stay with Ken, who they knew. Some wanted a Sharpe change.
So, out of that heated contest, of course, we arrived on May 13th, the Honorable Sharpe James, our mayor of the great city of Newark. And Newark has been moving forward ever since. Thank you, Sharpe, for the hard things to keep up to Newark, New Jersey. And I'm so honored to be a part of your Sharpe change in the great city of Newark, New Jersey.
Has been a ranking general in the Army of Sharpe James for many years. She served on the city council as both an at-large and central ward member before making an unsuccessful attempt to become Newark's first female mayor, a glass ceiling that still needs to be broken.
That's right.
As an office holder, she fought for quality health care, especially for children, and for expanding the acceptance and promotion of women in the workforce. Never one to mince words, she remains an activist and an outspoken critic of injustice. Gail.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's so good to be in a place where love is felt. I've lost that feeling in my own city.
Yeah.
I've lost that loving feeling. But looking around this room, many of you I've had the opportunity to work with, work for, work because of, because we were Newark who understood that Newark is to be loved. And Sharpe James loved this city to life. That I used to get upset with Mayor James when we would go places, and especially in the business community, they would refer to him as the cheerleader of the city of Newark. And I know people think that was a compliment, and it was, but it was an understatement. And one day we were in the Prudential Hall on Broad Street, and we were at a breakfast, and the corporate Newark was there, and they said, we're going to introduce Sharpe. And they said, Gail, you couldn't say something about him? And they said, we want to talk about him being the cheerleader. And I was so proud to be able to stand there in front of all of corporate Newark and say, he is not the cheerleader. He is the architect. You are in the house. That was built by Sharpe. He has always been a fierce protector of Newark. He's been a father to Newark. But he's always made sure that he had people who loved Newark just as much as he did. He was brave enough to be courageous to put qualified people in positions. Something you don't see nowadays, qualified people in positions to do the work for the community to make the city a better place. You know, that's kind of foreign here now. But Sharpe did it. And he made sure that he didn't just put people there because he liked them. He didn't put people there just because he knew them. He put them there because he gave them an opportunity to be better and make the city better. And if you were going to make the city better, he gave you more chances. And if you didn't make the city better, he wouldn't get rid of you, he would move you. But he still let you eat. And that's the difference. You know, my best position saw an article that said the ranking of cities and around the world, and it said Newark was 56th in the world economy. And we were ranked before Amsterdam, and we were ranked before, and I had to, I read it, and I went to the city hall that next day, and I said to Mayor James, what the hell is in this city that we're in front of Norway and all these other places? And he said, yeah, the port, the transportation, the access. He said, it's about North. He said, but the greatest asset we have in here is the people. He did so many things, and he was a great person to work with, and he was a great person to fight with. Because you know, if you knew Sharpe for longer than 5 minutes, you're going to have a fight. And we had some battle royale. And he brings it out of you. He makes you a better competitor. And there were times when the council, we had to turn around and jump on. And there were times when he tried to jump on us. There was times when he was jumping on us, he would turn around and call his reinforcements. I see Mr. Monte over there, me and him. Let me get it out of the way. I love your ass, Richard. I love your ass. You know I love. But see, North is a jewel. And Sharpe made sure he polished it. He protected it, he defended it. And he made sure that when people came into a partnership with North, that they were real. Some of them don't get that when you go home.
Yeah.
just say that to say, Sharpe James always made people feel good, whether you were from Newark, whether you were visiting Newark. He represented the image, the honesty, the decency, the love was felt. We've had our opportunity. People always say you can't compare apples to oranges. This city has been able to compare apples to apples. You've been able to compare competency to incompetency. You've been able to compare a room of love and people being able to have political differences and still speak to each other. As opposed to being enslaved. You all look around, this is what freedom looks like. This is what real constituency looks like. And we thank you for that, Sharpe. We thank you for that. I remember this thing when 9/11 happened.
Oh, yeah.
And